Started in part by New York State United Teachers, working with parents and the community for our children's future. NYSET, a union of professionals, and by viewers like you.
And welcome to Homework Hotline. I'm Joe Zuniga.
And I'm Laura Drake. Homework Hotline is the place where you can get help with your homework on the phone, online, or right here on TV.
And here's how the show works. There's Teach Them Dial, teacher standby right now to take your call and help you with your homework.
Now, if you'd like help with your homework, call Dial a Teacher free at 1-888-986-2345.
Now, you can also send your questions on our website, homeworkhotline.org. Just click on the Act Back button and send in your questions. All right, it's Tuesday, and that means it's time for our creature teaser.
All right, you will probably be able to find tonight's creature hanging around the trees, since this is where it spends most of its life. This animal moves very, very slowly, sometimes staying motionless in one place for long periods of time. Because of this, algae can begin to grow on this mammal's fur coat, which helps against helps it to be camouflaged against the green leaves of the Central and South American rainforest.
All right, now there are two different types of this creature, and they can be identified by the amount of long claws it has on its front feet. Now this creature can spend up to 20 hours a day sleeping in the trees, and this animal is an herbivore. Likes to eat shoots, leaves, and fruit, and even though this creature may seem lazy and slow, its long arms make it a good swimmer.
If you think you can solve the creature teaser, give our hotline a call at 1-866-264-5904 or just answer it on our website, homeworkhotline.org. Answer correctly and you could have a chance to share the answers at the end of this show.
But every correct response will be added to our Hotline Hall of Fame, and if you earn enough points, you can win a tablet at the end of the season. All right, Laura, you have an email question for us?
I do have an email question. We got this question from a seventh grader, and I'm gonna go over to the board and work on it. All right, so this question that we got in the email was 6 plus 7 times 65 plus 6 plus 72. And when you look at this, there's a lot of stuff going on. There's lots of numbers on here. And so mathematicians got pretty smart. They're like, oh, you can be adding, you can be subtracting. They come up with a rule that you're going to follow whenever you have to solve these really complex problems. And it's called order of operations. So when we do order of operations, we need to follow things in an order. And the thing that people usually use sometimes, PEMDAS. I am a big fan of GEMDAS, using a G instead. And this is going to help us to solve this problem and make sure that everybody solves it in the correct order. You don't always just solve it from left to right. You really just got to think about what the orders are here. So when I look here, the P or the G, I like the G stands for groupings, but I know a lot of people out there have learned parentheses. Okay, that's our parentheses. The E stands for exponents. And that's like when you have a power in the air or a square root. The M stands for multiplication, and the D stands for division. Now, the thing to know about those, even though you see the M written down first and then followed by the D, is that they're equal to each other. One's not more favorite than the other. You don't do one before the other. You don't do multiplication before division. You're going to do them the same. They're kind of like twins, okay? So whenever you get to those, you're going to do whoever comes first, from left to right, whichever one comes first. And then the same thing happens with the addition and the subtraction. You don't always do addition before subtraction. It's just when you read the problem as you go across the paper from left to right, which one of those comes first. So now we are ready to finally solve this problem now that we're clear of our order of operations. So we're going to look at the problem, and I'm going to see, are there anything that groups these together? That would be parentheses. It could be absolute value brackets. So when I look here, I see I have two sets of parentheses. So I'm going to go from left to right because I'm going to deal with parentheses. So 6 plus 7 is 13, and I'm going to do the other parentheses, which is 6 plus 72, which is 78. And so I'm done with the parentheses, but I'm going to bring everything else in the problem down. So we're done with parentheses. The next thing I'm going to look for is exponents. Is there anything that's got a power in it? Is there anything under a radical sign or a square root sign? And I look, and I don't have to do that one. So we're done. We get to cross that off our list. So now I'm looking for multiplication and division. Now, I know a lot of kids, when they look at this problem, they're going to want to add the two together because it's a lot easier to do. But you can't do it. You're going to get a different answer than what you're supposed to get. We have to look for the multiplication and division. And right here, I see some multiplication and division. I see 13 times 65. So I don't know that one off the top of my head. I'm going to have to multiply it out. 13 times 65. 3 times 5 is 15. Carry the 1. And that gets me 65. 6 times 3 is 18. I carry the 1. I get 780. I add them all up together, and I get 845. So 13 times 65 is 845. And I just bring that down. And now the only thing I have left is the plus 78, and I'm going to bring that down. Now I don't really have to worry too much about order operations because there's really no other operations left but 1, so I'm just going to do the 1 operation that's left. I'm going to do 845 plus 78. And 5 plus 8 is 13, 7 plus 4 is 11, and carry 1, and then carry the 1, and I get 923. So order of operations is going to keep you on track. It's a rule that everybody uses. Your teacher just didn't make it up. All mathematicians use it. So that'll help you to solve any problem. So thanks for that great email.
I said, hey, hey.
Need help with your homework? Find the number for where you live and then make the call.
Okay, now tomorrow is the chemistry regents for those students that are retaking the chemistry exam or those kids taking semester courses. So I thought it'd be kind of cool if we did a question based on the periodic table. Now this periodic table is the one that comes with the SmartBoard program. It's different than the one that you're used to seeing on your chemistry reference tables. But all periodic tables have certain things in common. One is the way that the elements and the atoms here are arranged. Now our modern periodic table is based on the atomic number. That's something we're going to talk about in just a second. But the atomic number is how these things are all arranged. Now, back in the 1800s, Mendeleev, a Russian scientist, came up with a table. He was one of the first ones to do that. What they noticed is that periodically, atoms or elements had the same type of chemical reactions. And so he started putting those in groups. Now, what he did, though, is he put his in group by mass instead of by the atomic number, which we're going to look at right now. But the atomic number is the number of protons in an element. Now, we know that all atoms contain 3 major particles that we talk about, protons, neutrons, and electrons, and then when you get into more chemistry and physics, you'll find out that there's even smaller particles yet. But those are the 3 what we call subatomic particles that we would deal with at the high school level. So let's take carbon, for example, here. Now, carbon, when I push it, notice it comes up, and there's 2 numbers here. There's a 12 and a 6. Now, this 6 is the atomic number. And if you noticed, back to our periodic table, we have hydrogen here, which would be 1, helium would be 2, 3 is lithium, 4 beryllium, 5 would be boron, and then 6 is carbon. So notice that these are arranged in order of increasing atomic number. Now there's gaps that are left here so that atoms with the same number of valence electrons, which means electrons in their outer shell, would be together, and that's what causes them to have the same chemical properties. That's the chemical properties, the binding is determined by the number of electrons in the outer shell. Well, with that said, if we look at this whole periodic table, we see there's a little staircase here. And that kind of divides the atoms on this side, the elements on this side, that tend to lose electrons. These are the metals, from the ones on the other side that tend to gain electrons. Those are the nonmetals. And then over here in the end here, this pinkish-purple row, are the ones that are called the noble gases. Those are the ones that don't tend to react with anything at all. Okay? So let's go back to our carbon. When it came up here with these 2 numbers, those 2 numbers, the atomic number and this one is atomic mass, is what students would use to determine the number of particles that are the subatomic particles that would make up this atom. So if we had 1 atom of carbon, excuse me, we just said that the atomic number, which is 6, is the number of protons. That would tell us the number of protons in the atom, but it would also tell us the number of electrons. All atoms are neutral charged because they have the same number of positive protons and the same number of negative electrons. The other thing is the neutrons. Now, to find the neutrons, this number here, the 12, is the atomic mass for this carbon. It's kind of confusing if you think about it this way. This is the number of nucleons. Now, in the nucleus, we find protons and neutrons. So the number of protons plus neutrons is the atomic mass, in this case, 12. For carbon, the number of protons by itself was 6. So 6 plus 6 would be 12. A carbon atom, a carbon 12 atom, also has 6 neutrons. Let's look at one that's a little bit different. We'll go back here to lithium. Remember, I said lithium was number 3. Lithium's atomic number is 3, which means it would have 3 protons, also 3 electrons. But we notice its mass number is 7. So 7 minus 3 gives us 4. It would have 4 neutrons. 3 protons, 4 neutrons. Together, 7 nucleons, or things in the nucleus, and because if this was an atom of lithium, it would then also have 3 electrons. So whenever you're looking at your periodic table, know there's a reason why these are arranged, and we'll talk more later about what these different rows stand for and what that periodic chemical properties we see. But the big thing is knowing your atomic number, atomic mass, and how to find the number of subatomic particles.
King Philip came over for great spaghetti. It's a silly way to remember the classification of animals and plants in science. The classification order is kingdom, phylum, class, order, family, genus, species.
Get back to questions in just a minute, but tonight we head to the Seneca Park Zoo to learn more about a monster. No, not the one you might find on your bed, but this is the one that lives in parts of North America. Take a look.
The scientific name for the Gila monster is Heloderma. Heloderma means bead-skinned in Latin, so they're kind of interesting in that their skin is so beaded, like the beaded lizard. It gives them a lot of texture. Not sure what purpose it serves. Their coloration also tells other would-be predators that they're possibly venomous and that they should stay away from them. A lot of animals will use bright colorations to tell other animals that they're either venomous or poisonous. We see it with dart frogs as well, or sometimes rattlesnakes, or coral snakes, for instance. And then we have other animals that will mimic that, and sometimes get away easier because they appear to be venomous, but they're not. In the case of the Gila monsters and the beaded lizards, they are venomous. They have venom glands, a lot like venomous snakes. They have grooved teeth, they don't have fangs, and they chew to get the venom into the victim. What's also interesting about Gila monsters is that they don't use their venom to kill prey items. They use them primarily for defense. Gila monsters pretty much always eat carrion. They're not very fast on foot, so they're not kind of ambush predators like most other reptiles would be. They usually try to come across something that's previously dead or maybe a bird's nest with eggs or young babies that are not easily able to escape. So Gila monsters are from the desert southwest of the United States, predominantly around the Sonora Desert, but also they range up into Utah and also into Mexico. Gila monsters usually grow to be about 1 kilogram or 2 pounds and 22 inches long. Gila monsters will burrow to stay out of the heat during the heat of the daytime. So they'll burrow to make it stay cooler. They do often create their own burrows, but they'll also use other burrows that were previously dug by other animals. One of the things they're looking at with Gila monster venom is using it to treat diabetes. So they've taken some of the components of the venom and they've made actually a synthetic drug that is modeled after some of the components in the venom of the Gila monster. Gila monster's conservation status in the wild is near threatened. That means they're nearly threatened with extinction. They're rarer than vulnerable.
Do you want to know more about the Gila monster and other monsters, other animals like it? Go to our website, homeworkhotline.org, and click on videos.
All right. No, I want to learn more about coordinate geometry.
Really? Yeah. I want to know more about chemistry. All right, I'm going to go on over to the board. And I want to do just a quick little mini lesson about plotting points, coordinate points on a graph. It's one of my favorite things to teach and one of my favorite things just to do for fun. Okay, so what we have here is the coordinate grid. And on the coordinate grid, before we can plot some points, is we need to know the parts of the coordinate grid. And an important thing to know is that this line that goes across, this is your x line, and your line that goes up and down is your y line. And the common thing that a lot of kids know is y to the sky. That's how you can remember it. So the y goes up and down, goes all the way up to the sky. So when I look at this graph, there's no numbers on here. There's a number line running through it. In the middle here, where the two go together, that's my zero. And when you put the marks on the line, the marks need to go on the line. They don't go in between. It's kind of like a line going right through the line. And then you put the numbers underneath it. So we're going to start with 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And I'm just going to go that far for each of them. And when we do the ones on the X line, it's really like the line is like an kind of X coming out of their head, okay? It's kind of weird, but it's like a line straight out of the top of it. So it's not next to it. And going backwards is going to be -1, -2, -3, -4, and we'll just go back to -5. Now we go up and down. That one's kind of easier because you think of it like a thermometer, and you've probably seen things that had numbers that go up and down. On this one, we're going to put the hash marks again, go directly on the line. And then going down the other way is the same thing. Okay, so now we have some numbers on the line that's going to help us graph. Now, as you start graphing for a little bit, you realize that you don't need the numbers. You can just kind of visualize really quickly how much you move over and how much you go up. So I'm going to show you how to do that right now. So the first point I want to graph, actually, before I talk about the first point, I want to talk about the center point, because this point in the middle, wow, that's a really important point. It's so important that it has its own name. It's the only point on the whole graph that has its own name, and that's called the origin. And that's right in the center, and that kind of makes sense. When you have the origin of something, it's where all things start. So when you do graphing, you have to start in the origin. And the coordinates of the origin are 0, 0. So let's talk about what 0, 0 means. Like, okay, its address is 0, 0. That means that its x value is going to be 0, and its y value is 0. Oop, let's make that look more like a y. So if I'm going to graph this graph, that means on the x line, the line that goes across, you're going to find the number 0. And then on the y line, you're going to find the 0. And that's where the data is. So that one's called our origin. So now we're going to plot some points that are a little bit more interesting. The origin is important, but it's not very interesting. So now we're going to do some more interesting points. The next point that I'm going to want to plot on here is 4, 6. So let's think about how we're going to graph 4, 6. We do the same thing every time, the exact same way. You start with x, and then you do y. And if you can't remember it, it's the same way as alphabetical, okay? So I'm going to start on the x line. A lot of times in my class, we like to talk about, like, the first number is like the elevator. So you want to get to the elevator. So if you walk in a store, and you got to get up to the 10th floor, you got to walk over to the elevator first. So I start at the origin, and I'm going to walk over to the number 4 elevator. So here I am. I'm walking over to the number 4 elevator, and as I see over, I'm here at the number 4. You don't normally put a mark there. I'm just putting it there to show you where we're going. And then the next number that we have is the number 6, which means you're going to get off on the 6th floor. So I go to the 4 elevator, and I go up. I don't have a 5 here, but I know that's the one after 6, and I'm going to put the dot right there. So I have 4, 6. And that would be the coordinate, the first coordinate that we put there. And you always label it so you know its address of where it is. So now we're going to try another point, okay? Let's try the point. Let's try and make it a little trickier. We're going to try the point -2, 5. Okay? So again, remembering that this is the x, the first one's the x, the second one is the y. You're going to start at the origin. You always start at the origin. Now, the fact that it's -2 tells me that I'm going to go backwards on the x line to the -2, and we could call it the -2 elevator as well. And then we're going to go up 5 floors. So we go up 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. I'm going to put a dot right there, and we have -2, 5. Now, when you notice, this one's on the other side of this line. That's okay. It's going to end up anywhere in this coordinate grid. All these points over here are going to be both positives. The ones down here are going to both be negatives. And these guys are kind of a mismatch. These are negatives in the beginning, and these have negatives in the end. So we're going to plot one or two more points. The next plot that I want to plot is the point 3, negative 2. And I'm hoping everybody's got the hang out of this. So we get an X and a Y. So we're going to go over to the 3 elevator. Then we're going to go down 2, and we put a dot right there. All right. So the last point I want to talk about, which is a really, really, really also important point that confuses people frequently, is when you have a point and it has a 0 in it. So I want to talk about the point 0, 4. Okay, so 0, 4, people get all confused. What do you do when you got a 0? So it tells me I'm going to stay on the 0 elevator. Okay, the 0 elevator, that's like the main elevator. That's like the best, quickest elevator. You don't even have to walk to it. You're right here. So I'm going to be on the 0 elevator, and I'm going to go up 1, 2, 3, 4. And that would be the point 0, 4. The last one to talk about is, what if I flip that? What if I did it 4, 0? So when you do that, you're going to have to walk over to the 4 elevator, and then you're like, I decided not to get on. You don't even go up any floor. So that would be right on. And it's perfectly okay to put a dot right on the line. So a lot of kids are like, oh, can I put a dot there? Sure, go right ahead. So I hope you learned a little bit about coordinate graphing. It's a lot of fun.
I said, hey, hey.
When dividing two fractions, find the reciprocal of the second fraction. Then multiply the fractions together to get your answer.
Okay, I feel better about my coordinates now.
All right. I want to feel better about chemistry.
Let's go. Well, I'm going to go over a question from last year's chemistry exam. We talked a little bit about the periodic table, and now I'm going to look at a question where we don't really need the table to answer this one, but it talks about some of the things we talked about. So this is the very first question of the test. It was one of the multiple choice, and it said, compared to the charge of a proton, the charge an electron has. So there are two keywords here as we're talking about protons and electrons. All right, remember before I said that an atom of an element is neutral because it has the same number of both. Protons actually have a positive charge, we talked about, and electrons have a negative charge. So now let's look at what our answers are. Number one says a greater magnitude and the same sign. All right, now when we're talking about magnitude, we're looking at the magnitude of the charge, okay? And remember I said that the atoms were neutral because they had the same number of protons as electrons, which means the magnitude of the positive charge on a proton is equal to the magnitude of the negative charge on electrons, so they can cancel each other out. So we know right away that numbers 1 and 2 aren't going to be correct because it doesn't have a greater magnitude. We said the same magnitude, we talked about that earlier, so we know it's the same magnitude, but if we notice the charge on the proton is positive and the charge on the electron is negative, they have an opposite sign. So we see the correct answer for this was number 4. So when you get a question like this, sometimes you got to think it through a little bit. And remember that we said if an atom can be neutral, then it has to have the same number of protons and electrons. The proton and electron must have the same magnitude of a charge, although they're opposite. So not a difficult question. Just got to think them through sometimes.
This country is comparable in size to Colorado or Japan, but it only has a population of about 4 million. Making it one of the world's least crowded countries. Although this country has gained its independence from Great Britain in 1907, Queen Elizabeth II is still the official head of state. New Zealand is actually a group of islands in the southeastern Pacific Ocean. The closest country to New Zealand is Australia, which is about 1,000 miles away. The islands of New Zealand were formed by volcanic forces pushing land out of the ocean. Today, New Zealand is still home to more than 50 volcanoes, some of which are still active. New Zealand has a spectacular landscape with lush greenery, mountains, and rainforests. Here's a fun fact about New Zealand. Because of the beautiful landscapes, the popular film trilogy, The Lord of the Rings, was filmed entirely in New Zealand.
All right, we've got a winner in our creature teaser. Jordan, are you there?
Yes.
Hello, Jordan.
Hi.
What was our answer?
A two-toed sloth.
A sloth, very good.
Sloth.
All right. Did you know that one, or did you have to look it up?
I had to look it up.
Well, that's good, and I'm glad you did. What did you learn about sloths you can share with us?
Oh.
Anything besides what we already said? Kind of funny when you think of these guys moving through the trees. They're so slow that they sometimes stay still for so long. They've got algae growing on them. And, you know, Laura was saying, how can they be good swimmers? How would they get in there? Well, occasionally they fall out of the tree right into the water. As we were talking about, that's how they end up being good swimmers. But they don't walk well at all on the land, right?
Yes.
Yeah. They kind of got to drag themselves along with their little two claws and their bellies dragging behind them.
Yeah.
So they could easily get eaten by predators, too. So they got to stay up in the trees.
Yeah. Well, I'm glad I'm not a sloth, aren't you?
Yeah.
All right, Jordan. Well, you did a great job. Congratulations. But don't forget now, every correct response goes in our Homework Hotline Hall of Fame. Earn enough points, you can win a tablet at the end of the season.
That's all the time we have for tonight. We are saying goodbye, but Dial-A-Teacher is available with free homework help on the phone until 7 o'clock tonight.
And now tomorrow on Homework Hotline, we'll continue our series called Move to Include. Good night.
Good night.
Homework Hotline is supported in part by New York State United Teachers, working with parents and the community for our children's future. NYSET, a union of professionals, and by viewers like you.